Warm greetings. I am Amitendu Palit, Senior Research Fellow at the Institute of South Asian Studies in the National University of Singapore. It's my pleasure to deliver this lecture. My lecture today is on the subject of economics and politics in the China-India relations, the new developments and emerging trends. In this paper, I look at the relationship between India and China, the two largest and most populous countries in the world and from Asia, and their impact upon the latest developments that have centered around them, influencing their bilateral relations, and what might those developments mean for the future relationships that these countries have in engaging with several other countries of the world, particularly in Central Asia. The topic that I address today through this paper is on the title of Economics and Politics in the China-India Relations, the New Developments and Emerging Issues. I start with a little bit of a background on the India-China relations, and I reflect on the fact that these are countries with very old civilizational histories, and between them, the history of exchange has been for several years and even centuries altogether. So the Sino-Indian ties go back to what many might know, to the celebrated Chinese Admiral Zheng He, when his fleet crossed the Indian Ocean several centuries ago and won his way to India in 410 CE. Admiral Zheng had visited Sri Lanka, recounting the experiences of his travel to India. And a prominent example of the joint initiatives by two countries in this regard that was witnessed later on in connection to their old history was also the employment of the Nobel laureate from India, poet Rabindranath Tagore, as a 21st century icon promoting Sino-Indian intercultural communication. And then subsequently, Mahatma Gandhi from India also became noted in China as a common point for greater people-to-people interface, with several Chinese universities hosting Center for Gandhian Studies, such as the Fudan University. There is, of course, the link to Buddhism, and Buddhism continues to remain a shared philosophy, reverberating across vast sections of both countries. And there is an extremely important role which religious preachers and Buddhism have played in reaching out and connecting with various communities. And it finds resonance in India's engagement with China as well. And it is on this background that both countries have actually come to a point in their relationship which took a turn from the culmination of the Second World War. That was a time when both countries actually moved on to two different paths in history. The first of which is that India started following a part of independent economic history from the year 1947 onward, once it achieved independence from being a colony. And China, too, moved on to the path slowly of that of a socialist economy following certain principles of socialist development. But the period after the Second World War was not a particularly robust period of economic engagement between the two countries. While both countries were recovering from the pangs of the Second World War and the troubles which they had subjected themselves as a result of oppression and colonial regimes as a result, what followed after an initial period of engagement between the two countries was actually a fairly bitter conflict in the decade of the 1960s, which led to both countries clashing in the Himalayas in the early 1960s. And from that point in time, there was a suspension of diplomatic relations between the two countries, which subsequently got resumed again from the late 1970s and went on to become much more comprehensive in the decades that followed thereafter. With this brief introduction, I now turn to the first illustrative section of my paper and the lecture, which is on the modern economic and political relations that are in so far as the current characterization of the India-China relationship is concerned. And as I just mentioned, since the revival of diplomatic relations in 1978, the Sino-Indian relations returned to normalcy, and for several decades, they went on to encompass several spheres, and this include their mutual engagement on subjects of global concern, notably climate change, a fast-growing trade and business relationship, and greater interface between people and agencies on both sides. There was a problem of a dispute which these countries have had on a fairly long border in the Himalayas, one of the longest borders that is subject of a dispute in modern history. The two countries did, however, stay engaged in discussions on resolving the national border disputes and culminated in the border defense agreement between India and China that was signed in October 2013, outlining the structure of an arrangement intended to return peace through mutual cooperation on the borders. Now, while all these happened and economic engagement between the two countries expanded, as did their collaboration and occasional points of disagreement on a number of subjects in the global space, the last 5 years have noted a particular increase in the degree of mistrust and suspicion between the two countries. Both countries are large economies. Both countries are very large insofar as their geographies and populations are concerned. Both countries have been developing economies, but at the same time, they have harbored ambitions of becoming major and prominent powers in the regional and global order. And China, of course, has made much greater strides in this regard and have been able to position itself as very close to the major pole of power in international relations, that's the United States. But on the other hand, India's rapid economic growth and economic expansion has also made it fairly ambitious in playing a prominent role insofar as its voice in regional global affairs are concerned. And the fact that both countries have been growing simultaneously, parallelly, looking forward to casting their respective influences in and around each other is something which eventually probably had to reach a stage where both countries had to look at the troubles around their relationship quite closely. And over the last 5 years, what we see is that there have been growing instances of skirmishes between the two countries, and these primarily have involved the face-offs in the Himalayas. A more than 1 month long standoff between troops at a place called the Doklam Plateau, at the tri-junction of India, China, and Bhutan in India's northeastern part that began from the June 2017 was ultimately resolved through diplomatic conversations. And the resolution of the standoff was also followed by the establishment of a particular confidence-building mechanism, which involved the Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi and the Chinese President Xi Jinping meeting exclusively one-on-one for informal summit talks between the two of them on two occasions, once in April 2018 at Wuhan in China, and the second time in October 2019 at Mamallapuram in India. Now, while these talks really did not make much of a difference to the resolution of the border dispute that that was existing between the two countries, it probably did help to create some degree of understanding on certain other matters, like, say, for example, the subject of Kashmir, as scholars argue. Kashmir, one of India's highest altitude states in the Himalayas, has been a disputed state between, parts of it have been disputed between India and Pakistan, and there has been a fairly bitter row in that regard. China has been an important ally of Pakistan, so it is very important for India to understand the Chinese posture on Kashmir. So probably This was one of the areas where the two leaders succeeded in making much progress and coming to an understanding that Kashmir eventually is a bilateral dispute between India and Pakistan, which needs to be settled between them bilaterally. But while this was a little bit of an understanding that the two countries and leaders achieved in this regard, much of what was achieved otherwise in terms of the continuation of a process of dialogue was lost in a very serious development that happened a few months ago at the Galwan Valley in the India's northern Himalayan state of Ladakh, where on the borders, clashes happened for the first time in more than four decades between the militaries of the two countries, leading to loss of several lives on both sides. Now, this has been to a very large extent a game changer in the India-China current level of their relationships. And as a result of this clashes, the hostilities or the quality of the relationship between China and India has really dipped very sharply. There have been several retaliatory reactions that have come, particularly in part of India, mostly on the economic side, while both countries continue to remain engaged on the diplomatic front. The troops still have not completely disengaged from the positions that they occupy in the Galwan Valley. And it probably has a bearing towards the fact that the current pattern of structural conversation that has been going on for resolution of the border dispute between the two countries is something which needs to be revisited, and far deeper engagement and understanding has to happen. In the next section of my paper, what I explore are what have been the broader reasons that have been happening in the rest of the world and in the region around India and China, which have had an impact on their relations? Because I think the India-China relationship and the developments in that relationship need to be looked at from the point of view of two sets of determinants. The first is those which are entirely bilateral and which are probably coming out more from the historical disputes that exist between them, as I just alluded to in terms of the border and other issues. But another set of determinants are probably on result of a number of developments that are happening around the two of them in the region and the rest of the world, which neither can escape and stay immune from as far as influences are concerned, because these are extremely significant developments and they impact the India-China relations, and they also impact the way India and China engage with other countries of the world. So I would allude to three specific developments in this regard. The first is the nature of the relationship that currently prevails between the United States and China. The second is the Belt and Road Initiative project that China has embarked on a few years ago. And third is the evolution of the concept of the Indo-Pacific order in India and China's neighborhood. I first begin with the US-China relations, and the Trump presidency has seen a particular trend towards the acceleration of hostilities between the United States and China, and the most pronounced evidence of this has been in the trade relations. There has been a tendency on part of the Trump administration to repeatedly charge tariffs on various Chinese imports on the grounds that China has been one of those countries which has unfairly benefited from its trade relationship with the US. China has retaliated by imposing counter tariffs, which has led to the onset of a trade war between the two countries. Both countries, however, succeeded in hammering out a deal between the two of them, which was finalized in January 2020. And there were expectations that this deal would lead to an end of the trade war. But unfortunately, this deal was only a partial deal, and there were a number of subjects which remained unresolved, particularly those of the US concern, which included the discriminatory treatment of American businesses in China. Those were all supposed to be handled later in another subsequent round of discussions that would take place between the two countries, and there were more phases of the US-China trade deal that were expected to be announced. But unfortunately, two factors have led to stoppage of discussions on the particular deal or on the progress of it. The first of it is the outbreak of the COVID-19. And the second is the onset of the US presidential elections. So US-China trade relations continue to remain a matter of tension, and they would probably take very long to resolve. But in the meantime, there have been developments around China's neighborhood, and particularly in Hong Kong, as well as in Taiwan, which have further contributed to the souring of relations between United States and China. And Hong Kong, as we know, there has been the announcement of a particular legislation, security legislation, which the Hong Kong government has been using effectively since June 2020 for curbing protests and dissents within Hong Kong. And the United States and several other Western democracies have charged China for this legislation being the first of the decisive steps in curbing democracy in Hong Kong with the help of a pro-mainland government in Hong Kong. And along with the attention on Hong Kong, there has also been far greater US engagement of Taiwan, which one believes to an extent could also be a retaliatory strategy for keeping China in check. And if the United States does get to formally recognize Taiwan at some stage in the foreseeable future, then the possibility of military escalation and military confrontation between the two countries in the region cannot be ruled out. And the US-China relations have also soured considerably following the outbreak of the COVID-19 and the controversies surrounding it. And President Trump has repeatedly alluded to the COVID-19 as the China virus. And along with the controversies surrounding COVID-19, there have also been heightened anxieties expressed over companies like the Huawei and the fact that they have strong links with the Chinese Communist Party and their advances in various national economies of the world in the technology space enables them to collect information from national country citizens and share them, critical information with the Chinese Communist Party. And this has led to the US efforts to push Chinese firms out of several national domestic technology spaces and also banning Chinese digital content providers, the popular ones like TikTok and WeChat. And the anti-China rhetoric is in no way going to stop immediately, because even if there is a change in the United States administration following the elections, the anxiety and mistrust over China appears to be somewhat bipartisan in the United States. So as the US-China relations continue to drift and kind of become quite difficult to handle as far as the rest of the world is concerned, the fact remains that during the time when the hostilities with China have increased, have also been the time when the Indian proximity with the US has grown quite considerably, particularly as far as the defense relationship between India and the United States is concerned. The partnership has expanded significantly, which probably has caused China to become a little bit more wary about whether India actually is siding discreetly or even not discreetly anymore with the United States in becoming a counterbalance to China's growing influence in the region. The second factor that I alluded to, which has also had a bearing upon the India-China current relationships and the tensions surrounding it, is the Belt and Road Initiative. Now, the Belt and Road Initiative is a humongous connectivity project, and it has the land, maritime, and digital elements to the huge connectivity spaces that it assumes, revisiting the old Silk Road transit concept and connecting the contiguous landmasses beginning from Western Europe, Africa, Central Asia, the Middle East, South Asia, Southeast Asia to the Far East is concerned, and then connecting the South China Sea, Indian Ocean, parts of the Pacific on the backward side, and then further downward to the westward to the Mediterranean, the Persian Gulf. And it's really a huge project of multimodal dimensions. And that kind of a project clearly has geopolitical dimensions to it as well. And India has been one of the major critics of this project right from the beginning, primarily because of two reasons. India has specific territorial concerns that a part of the BRI, the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, actually passes through Kashmir, a part of Kashmir which India claims has been illegally occupied by Pakistan. And to that extent, this China-Pakistan economic corridor, which is a part of the BRI, infringes upon India's territorial interests. And on the other hand, India has also drawn attention to the fact that as China begins engaging countries with the promise of funding them on infrastructure projects, for a region in Asia and around Asia where countries are hungry for infrastructure funds and they don't have recourse to such funds, the ability of China to fund infrastructure projects might come with a price, and these countries might actually get financially debt-trapped. And with China helping them out for building infrastructure, China might actually demand strategic concessions on that regard, and the countries might actually be forced to compromise on their strategic autonomy. So the bigger fear for India in this regard has been that China might actually be able to build a group of strategically aligned partners around India in South Asia and Southeast Asia, maybe also in partly in Middle East and Central Asia, which would be to India's disadvantage. Now, the fact is that the concerns that India raised over a point in time have also been concerns which have partly this way or that way been articulated by other countries of the world, particularly in the West, including in Europe. But from a Chinese perspective, the Belt and Road Initiative was actually its objective of changing the global order in a very substantive fashion, a fashion that would be symptomatic and symbolic of China establishing a world order where it plays a substantially commanding role on the grounds that it is a spearheader of development and therefore the new global order. But the fact that India has really attacked the virtuous aspect of the Belt and Road has not made India an endearing proposition to China. And India occupies a strategic position in the Belt and Road geography. So without India's cooperation, it's very difficult for the Belt and Road project to proceed to a logical conclusion. There has also been the Indo-Pacific country, which the Indo-Pacific articulation very forcefully by the United States since President Trump became president. And this essentially is very clear from the articulation of the concept that it essentially looks to counterbalance China's influence in the region by bringing together a group of like-minded democracies, primarily India, Japan, Australia, and other democracies in the India-Asia-Pacific region as a group, along with the United States, to work on subjects of development, economics, and also being a security provider for the region through an initiative which is called the popularly called the Quad or the Quadrilateral Security Dialogue, an initiative which had shaped between India, Japan, and Australia and the US in the wake of the tsunami in the Indian Ocean several years ago, and which has again been revived 3 years ago as a security framework, being engaged in greater security conversations and discussions between them. The latest meeting, ministerial meeting of the Quad, took place a week ago in Tokyo. And there is no doubt about the fact that this is something which is a botheration for China. China has actually reacted to this as an initiative by a group of countries which can be described as an exclusive click and trying to bother the third party interests. And this is where, to a very large extent, China sees the Indo-Pacific community developing as a counterbalance to take on its influence in the Asia-Pacific. Now, while these three are the major factors which have on their own contributed to the deepening mistrust between India and China, with India becoming an important part of the Indo-Pacific, India being a vocal critic of the BRI, India getting increasingly close to the United States, the United States-China relationships taking a bitter turn, nosedive downward. All these have impacts for a number of countries which India and China are separately going to engage with over the years to come. And these include the Central Asian countries. So insofar as a widening rift between the India-China relations are concerned, what might that mean for countries in Central Asia, which are obviously eager to engage with both India and China? I reflect on two particular elements of this likely fallout. The first is on the trade side. And over time, we have seen historically in a multilateral trade forum like the WTO, India and China have worked together in supporting the interests of the developing countries, particularly on the Doha Development Agenda in the early part of the century. But over time, in WTO, their instances of combined efforts have become much less. And that is primarily because China is now looking to position itself much more of a global rules setter when it comes to multilateral trade and the new emerging issues, like, say, for example, e-commerce, or in areas like data and data developments. And this is where India continues to remain on a somewhat different position. So the enlarging distance between two countries is evident from the fact that India has stayed out of the plurilateral e-commerce talks, which are happening on the sidelines on global e-commerce rules, which includes China, but does not include India. And in fact, there are Central Asian countries, like, say, for example, the Kyrgyz Republic and the Tajikistan, which have not joined e-commerce talks, but Kazakhstan has nonetheless entered these talks. So there's already sign of a division that is being seen among the Central Asian economies and their perspectives on the e-commerce talks and the modern issues going together. And there is also a division of views between India and China on how to take these issues forward and the possibilities of their combining on global issues of substantive importance in the days to come appears to be relatively less, and the possibility of their beginning to engage with the Central Asian economies and other economies in other parts of the world with their differing visions and trying to persuade them to lock on to various country alliances which they respectively lead in this regard is quite real. So it will be a question of choice as far as the Central Asian economies are concerned. And this is where I wanted to come to my final point, that the choice as far as the Central Asian economies are concerned is also going to be primarily on technology and economics, because the pushback against Chinese companies in the technological space, which has begun from the United States and is now being taken over by a large number of Western democracies, has also extended to India, because companies like the Huawei have been pushed out of India's 5G technological space. India has blocked several Chinese apps which were popular in the country. This is particularly after the developments that happened in the clashes around Galwan Valley earlier in the year. And it is very clear that when it comes to technology, technology standards, the role of the Huawei, and so on and so forth, India is going to be on a different trajectory from China. But at the same time, Chinese companies, particularly Huawei, particularly ZTE and others, have been very prominent in certain Central Asian economies in helping in the development and growth of technological infrastructure in these countries. So to that extent, the question that remains is that when it comes to technology, which is the next frontier of connectivity and global growth, even when it comes to the Belt and Road Initiative, which is a very prominent cyber arm to itself in terms of the information silk road, there will obviously be considerable effort on part of China. China has a first mover advantage to consolidate the position of its own companies and businesses in many Central Asian economies. But that will be challenged. That will be challenged in terms of other offers and other perspectives and other views that are offered, not just by India, but other economies of the world, including the United States and Japan. So for the Central Asian economies in that respect, it becomes a question of making difficult choices. And the bigger problem in this regard is that today, with the world looking to get split, particularly in Asia, around pro-China and anti-China alliance of countries, there will always be an effort on part of China and those not around it to engage the rest with offers to join their own respective political and economic alliances. And to that extent, as of now, it looks that with the Indo-Pacific gaining traction, the Indo-Pacific might even become a counter-alternative to the Belt and Road Initiative of China. The Indo-Pacific constitutes countries like India, Japan, and Australia, and they might actually be reaching out to countries from Central Asia, like in other parts of Asia, offering them a different vision of development and regional order, including technological and economic choices which are not of the Chinese group of people. And at that point in time, might also be getting highlighted by the fact that there has been a credibility issue with the Chinese technology businesses. So all in all, these are going to be difficult choices for Central Asia as they go ahead. And with the India-China relationship having taken a complex turn because of disputes that exist between themselves and their flare-up, and also because of the developments surrounding them, it doesn't look like this relationship is going to become harmonious pretty soon. So whatever be the implications in this relationship, there's going to be a concomitant impact of those implications on the Central Asian republics as well. This is where I conclude my lecture, and I'll be very happy to discuss more on this with those of you interested. Thank you very much.